Why are the LHC experiments so big? To answer this, we need to consider the extreme conditions in which we're operating when we look for the Higgs signal, and appreciate the hostility of the Hadron Collider environment and the huge collision rates. We have already seen the animation of the two protons colliding inside the heart of the detector. In reality, you do not have two isolated protons colliding. Protons are grouped in bunches containing about 100 billion protons each and colliding against each other practically at the speed of light. This creates the intimidating rate of about 1 billion collisions per second. If you are lucky, maybe one of these collisions will produce a Higgs boson. This detail is the most surprising thing for people that are not familiar with Hadron Colliders. The notion that we're looking for something that happens extremely rarely, about one event per second, while the total collision rate, everything else that is happening inside the detector, occurs at a rate of about 1 billion collisions per second. And they ask, how do you do this? We do this with a trigger, a very sophisticated hardware and software system that you should think of as a 100 megapixel digital camera that takes snapshots of the detector activity every 25 nanoseconds. That is, every 25 billionths of a second. And based on that information, we choose the collisions that look most interesting by making a highly calculated selection of the most promising tiny slice of data for capturing a Higgs boson, or new physics for that matter. What is the output of this? A few hundred events per second. We start with 1 billion, we select the best few hundred every second. So we're talking about a 1 in 10 million selection mechanism. And the selection process determines 99.9999% of the physics interactions the collaboration will be able to analyze, ever. This explains why these experiments, these highly sophisticated digital cameras, are so large and complex. They have to make the right decision and they have to make it fast. When a decision is made, it's made forever. If a mistake is made, there's no undo button. The two experiments that announced the discovery of the Higgs boson in July 2012 are ATLAS and CMS. The ATLAS detector is 45 meters long, 25 meters in diameter, and weighs about 7,000 tons. The collaboration consists of more than 3,000 physicists from all over the world. The CMS detector is more compact in size. It is 25 meters long, 15 meters in diameter, but weighs even more than the ATLAS detector, about 12,500 tons. The CMS collaboration has also more than 3,000 physicists from all over the world. Why have two experiments instead of one? Because we need independent confirmation of any claim of a scientific discovery. It is very difficult, but not entirely impossible, for a collaboration to make a mistake, to claim a false discovery. It is much more difficult to have two independent collaborations make the same mistake. This mechanism of independent confirmation or rejection of an experimental observation is the cornerstone of the scientific method. When experimentalists started looking for the Higgs boson, they did not know its mass. But the theoretical tools that we have allow us to calculate the probability that a Higgs will decay to a given set of particles as a function of the hypothetical mass. This is demonstrated in this plot. You can see that the probability that the Higgs decays to a big quark and its antiparticle, the B bar, or two W bosons, or two Z bosons, or two tau leptons, or two photons, is very different for different hypothetical values of the Higgs mass. Since we don't know what the Higgs mass is, we have to look at several different channels to make sure that we will be able to observe the Higgs decay no matter what. This animation shows what it looks like when a Higgs boson decays into two photons. The two photons are represented by the two solid green towers. the very energetic photons get fully absorbed by a specialized detector called the calorimeter. We can measure the deposited energy of the photons. When combined, the energy of the two photon system can give us the mass of the Higgs boson. This was a single collision giving us a single measurement for the mass of a potential Higgs boson. We still do not know if this collision corresponds to the decay of a real Higgs boson. We collect thousands upon thousands of similar collisions. And we put together the reconstructed mass of all these potential Higgs decays, which we call Higgs candidates, into a single plot. This plot is made from ATLAS, and a very similar plot produced by CMS. These plots are still not enough evidence to claim that we have discovered the Higgs. A statistical analysis is needed to evaluate any potential deviation that stands out from the background that looks like a Higgs. The goal of the statistical analysis is to quantify the probability in the event that there is no Higgs that we could have a fluctuation caused exclusively by the background that looks so much like a Higgs peak, and if there is a Higgs, to determine its mass. This is typically at the place of the observed deviation. We can see very clear deviations in both plots, and they both appear at the same place, around 125 GeV. But this is just the diphoton channel. Here's another animation showing what it looks like when a Higgs decays to two Z bosons. One of the Z bosons decays to an electron and a positron. These are again depicted as solid green towers. They look very similar to photons, but these particles are charged, so they leave ionization traces in a dedicated detector made of semiconductor material. The second Z boson decays to a muon and an anti-muon pair. Muons interact very weakly with our detector. They are able to travel very far without being absorbed by the calorimeter like the electrons or the photons. When we combine the energy of the electron and the positron and the momenta of the reconstructed muons, we can calculate the mass of the Higgs candidate. This is the plot that combines all the potential Higgs decays to two Z bosons for ATLAS. This plot looks very different than the diphoton distribution shown earlier. It is a cleaner channel with fewer events and a very different background shape. The three colored histograms are hypothetical simulated Higgs signals with different mass values. The points correspond to the experimental data and they agree with a simulated Higgs signal with a mass of 125 GeV. And this is a similar plot produced by CMS. CMS has chosen here to zoom in at the place of the observed deviation. The red line histogram is again a hypothetical simulated Higgs distribution that matches very well the experimental data points around 126 GeV. The value of 126 GeV is compatible with the value reported by ATLAS. The two measurements are consistent within the experimental resolution. So we have observations of deviations from the background in different channels in the Higgs searches. But if there is a Higgs that decays to multiple channels, the individual deviations that we observe have to give a coherent picture. This means two things. Not only provide cumulative evidence of a Higgs boson, but also give mass measurements that are consistent with each other. Furthermore, we have two independent experiments with very similar sensitivity. If one experiment claims a discovery, and the discovery is real, it would be extremely unlikely that the other experiment would not observe anything. If both experiments claim a discovery, they also have to agree on the Higgs mass. Can we combine the information from the individual channels to quantify how unlikely it is to observe these deviations if there are no Higgs? This is an extremely complex problem that requires very CPU-intensive calculations and tedious cross-checks. The results presented by CMS are shown in this plot. A channel with a very high sensitivity is the one with the two Z bosons discussed earlier and appears with a red color. It shows that the probability to observe such a deviation without a real Higgs behind it is smaller than 1 in 1,000. Even more sensitive is the diphoton channel depicted with a green color. The corresponding probability is almost 1 in 100,000. The combination with the black color shows that the probability that we would observe these deviations in all channels together if there were no Higgs is smaller than 1 in a million. What is important here is that the incorporation of multiple channels contributes constructively in the evidence for the existence of the Higgs and that the individual deviations appear at the same mass value. This is similarly the combined plot for ATLAS extended over a wide mass range. When looking at the full mass spectrum, we can observe small fluctuations in several places or mass values. Most of them do not suggest that there is a Higgs, as they are perfectly consistent with a fluctuation caused exclusively by background. There is a very large deviation, however, around 125 GeV. The calculations show that if there were no Higgs, the combined probability to observe all these deviations in the different channels is almost as low as 1 in 10 million. The experimental observation by ATLAS crosses a standard conventional threshold for claiming the discovery of a new particle that is referred to as a 5 sigma deviation. The experimental evidence for the discovery of the Higgs boson was presented on July 4, 2012 in a joint seminar by ATLAS and CMS at CERN. The audience included Peter Higgs and other theorists that worked on the theory almost 50 years earlier. The announcement of the discovery was met with standing ovation, something extremely unusual in particle physics seminars. The Higgs discovery was the last piece missing in the standard model, a system of sophisticated equations that can predict a very large range of phenomena with very high accuracy. But here's the great paradox. It turns out that all these wonderful equations that we have describe extremely well only 5% of the known universe. We know now that dark matter and dark energy make up the majority of the world, 95%. What is dark matter and dark energy? We don't know. How is it possible that we understand so extremely well 5% of the known universe and everything we see, and know absolutely nothing about what makes up most of the world? We don't know. These are some of the questions we're trying to answer at the LHC. Are there yet new particles waiting to be discovered? Is there a connection between the Higgs boson, these new particles, and the dark matter or the dark energy? We think that measuring the properties of the Higgs boson will give us some clues that will allow us to start answering some of these questions.